Turn in your Bibles to Micah chapter 5. We are going to look at a message I've entitled The Incomparable Babe of Bethlehem. The Incomparable Babe of Bethlehem. The very mention of that little town stirs the hearts of Christians around the world, does it not? The Incomparable Babe of Bethlehem. We love to sing, don't we? Once in Royal David's City. Where is that place, and what are we actually singing about, and what makes Bethlehem so profoundly significant? I've had the privilege, as some of you know, of leading a few study tours in Israel and another one coming up next year, and it's a bit of a shocker or an eye-opener for Christians to visit modern Bethlehem for the first time. To get there, you have to travel 10 Ks outside of modern Jerusalem. You enter into the border of the Palestinian West Bank. Because of terrorism and suicide bombers, there is now a 30-meter-high, massively thick concrete wall that stretches for many Ks. And just to get into the little town of Bethlehem, you have to go through this heavily guarded, highly armed security checkpoint to get to Bethlehem. Once you're there, you see that this barrier has drastically affected the economy, and you enter into a Bethlehem and a Palestinian area that is visibly much poorer and more run down than the city of Jerusalem. You soon find out that a city, Bethlehem, a town, that once was predominantly Christian for centuries, up to some 80, 90% Christian, now predominantly Muslim, barely any Christians left in Bethlehem. You then travel, of course, to the famous Church of the Nativity, built over the cave in which Mary probably gave birth. From the second century, Christians had been gathering there, worshiping. It's for that reason that the Emperor Hadrian, pagan Roman ruler in AD 135, built a pagan shrine and temple over that cave to stop Christians from worshiping Jesus in that spot. But God providentially used his schemes to mark that spot quite well. And so when Christianity was legal under the Emperor Constantine, his mother in 325, Helena, built a building, some of which still stands today, perhaps the oldest surviving church building on the planet, Church of Nativity. You enter and you will see floor mosaics that go all the way back to the original building from Constantine, AD 330. Artwork by Christians, 1,700 years old. It's pretty amazing. After this, the church was partially destroyed about 300 years later by the Samaritans, 6th century. Only 40 years after that, the Emperor Justinian rebuilt it. Much of that building still stands today, 14 centuries later. This Church of the Nativity there in Bethlehem has survived many sieges over the years. Most recently, a 5-week standoff, some of you may recall, about 20 years ago, when Muslim militants ran for refuge inside this Church of Nativity. As you walk through this historic church, you walk down to the cave where probably there or somewhere near there, the eternal Son of God entered time and space and stepped into our world. It's a pretty paradoxical experience. The wonder of the Christian story, the weight and truth and significance of it all, clashing with the man-made clutter and the layer upon layer of Christian tradition and different Christian faiths competing, all the icons and the altars that are there, the smells and the bells, the censers and the relics and the rituals. Bethlehem is this place that announced peace to the world, and yet it's marked by so much turmoil and conflict today. Part of what drives us back to this text there, look in your Bibles at Micah chapter 5, one of the great Christmas prophecies. We can learn what God wants us to learn about this very paradoxical but very precious and important place in the history of our Christian faith. Answering the call of the hymn writer, come ye, oh come ye, to Bethlehem. As is our custom here on Sundays, let's stand as we read our passage in honor of God's word. Please rise. Micah 5 from verse 1. Follow as I read. The prophet Micah, this is writing before the exile of the Jewish people into Babylon. He says, "Now muster yourselves in troops, daughter of troops. They have laid siege against us. With a rod they will smite the judge of Israel on the cheek. But as for you, Bethlehem Ephrathah, too little to be among the clans of Judah, from you one will go forth for me to be ruler in Israel. His goings forth are from long ago, from the days of eternity. Therefore he will give them up until the time when she who is in labor has borne a child. Then the remainder of his brethren will return to the sons of Israel. And he will arise and shepherd his flock in the strength of the Lord and in the majesty of the name of the Lord his God. And they will remain, because at that time he will be great to the ends of the earth. This one will be our peace." Please join me as we pray. Our Father, we think of many here in this sanctuary this morning, all of us at times, whose lives are like the paradox of Bethlehem, so holy and yet unholy, peace and yet war, profound and real and important and yet cluttered and often distracted, needing to peel back the layers of tradition and man-made rituals to rediscover the truth behind it all, the bedrock of what you have done in history in the person of your Son. Help us by your Spirit today afresh to come and adore him, to learn from the classroom of Bethlehem, as it were, to visit the school and the academy of Bethlehem, to learn the biblical truths that we might worship Christ, that some might come to believe in Christ for the first time, and that we who know him might adore and follow and love and obey him all of our days. In the name of our incarnate Lord, we pray. Amen. You may be seated. Let me remind you, when the wicked King Herod wanted to identify where this Messiah boy, this Christ child in Matthew chapter 2 was to be born, what was the very GPS, the original Google Maps, the homing pigeon, you might say, or if you prefer to use Waze? How did they locate the very spot where they would find this Jesus, the prophecy of Micah? We read in Matthew chapter 2, you don't need to turn there. "Gathering together all the chief priests and scribes of the people, Herod inquired of them where the Messiah was to be born. They said to him, 'In Bethlehem of Judea, for this is what has been written by the prophet.'" And then Matthew quotes Micah 5, verse 2, which we've just read. And then we read there in Matthew's gospel, "And Herod sent them to Bethlehem and said, 'Go and search carefully for the child. And when you have found him, report to me so that I too may come and worship him.'" Yeah, right. That's Matthew goes on to tell us how this same town that brought life into the world would soon be covered with death. Bloodthirsty Herod killing all the male children, right? 2 years old and under, in fulfillment of Jeremiah's prophecies elsewhere in the Old Testament. This place that once had heard the voice of angels ringing was about to be filled with the sound of mothers weeping. Bethlehem, this place of such disturbance and yet comfort, of sorrow and yet joy. I read just last week from a writer that I follow, a Jewish Christian writer named Joel Rosenberg, who is now based in Israel. Fascinating, he describes. With the exception of the most religious Jews, Israelis right now are becoming fascinated by Christmas. You see, they've all watched the movie Home Alone, he says. They've seen lots of other Christmas movies and TV shows. They've heard Christmas music. And we all see many Israeli Arabs celebrating Christmas. The traditions, the whole spirit of the season is inviting to them. It's intriguing. Thousands of Israelis every year, including today, stream through the Anglican Christ Church, I think that would be through the Jaffa Gate in the west of the Old City, and They want to see the lights and the decorations, usually on Christmas Eve, that would have been yesterday. They want to hear the carols being sung. Even sometimes they'll listen to a Christian sermon. These are Israeli Arabs and Jews. So he and his wife decided to hold a Christmas party for neighbors in their Israeli village recently. He says, the place was packed. Our house was bursting. I could hardly believe it. However, it got very interesting when we asked various guests to read in Hebrew the messianic prophecies from the Tanakh, what they call the Old Testament as we know it. He says we had them read from Isaiah 9, and then we got to Micah 5. It baffled our guests. One older Israeli gentleman asked me, and you know how Israelis converse in a very animated fashion. Are you saying that the Messiah absolutely has to be born in Bethlehem? He seemed irate. No, I'm not saying that, I replied. The Hebrew prophet Micah, sent by God, is telling us that. Then he became even more upset. I was born and raised in this land. I went to Israeli schools. I studied the Hebrew Bible in class year after year. No one ever showed me this prophecy. No one ever told us Messiah was to be born in Bethlehem. Then he puts his finger on my chest, says Rosenberg. Joel, you need to go to our education minister and yell at him and tell him, why have you kept this from us? Why aren't you telling us what our own Bible teaches about Messiah? Rosenberg replies, well, I'm pretty new to this country. I'm not sure that's the right job for me. I'd kind of like to stay here for a while. Perhaps it'd be better for you to go and have that conversation. Rosenberg concludes, in the years that have followed, this experience has been confirmed to me and my wife again and again. While even the youngest of Christian children know the biblical significance of Bethlehem, most Israelis today, in fact, most Jews worldwide, don't even know one of the most important messianic prophecies is found in the little book of Micah. They really don't know that God sovereignly decided and announced long beforehand through his servant Micah exactly where Messiah would be born. Before we get into our outline, look at how verse 1 sets the stage here, friends. It's not with a promise of peace. It is a call to arms that this Christmas prophecy opens up with, not announcing joy, but declaring war. Look at the text, Micah 5, verse 1. Now muster yourselves in troops, daughter of troops. They've laid siege against us. He's telling the great city of Jerusalem, brace yourselves for a foreign invasion. And then the epitome of Jerusalem's defeat and her humiliation would be what we read next. Verse 1, with a rod they will smite the judge of Israel on the cheek. An insulting foreign attack. The king himself gets a slap in the face. An enemy would take the very scepter from the king's hand, as it were, and use it to strike him. You wonder, was this fulfilled in history, we should be asking? If so, how? We know that about 100 years after Micah's time, 586 BC, Jerusalem falls to the hands of Babylonians, right? In 2 Kings 25, we read how these cruel Babylonians treated Judah's king at the time. Anybody remember? Starts with a Z, ends with a H. King Zedekiah. They pluck out his eyes. They march him off to Babylon. Micah prophesies this brutal striking of Israel's ruler on the face. But that may not be the final fulfillment. Remember, the prophets often saw through a telescope with multiple fulfillments, depending on how you focus the lens. Many scholars believe this prophecy here in verse 1 of shame upon a Jewish ruler could include the bloody persecutions under other tyrants, Antiochus Epiphanes, right? Herod, the Romans, the defeat of Jerusalem in AD 70 under Titus. This prophecy could even include Israel's greatest king ever, the true king of the Jews, repeatedly struck on the cheek, spat upon, mocked, crucified, buried, and on the third day he rose. Beloved, already we need to notice, Micah is about to give us great news, Israel and the world, triumph, Christmas hope. But the only people ready to receive this hope are the ones who see how hopeless we are without this child of Bethlehem. They have faced the grave reality of their situation apart from God. How about you here this morning, Christmas morning? We too can only appreciate and really grasp the Christ of Christmas, the hope of salvation. Once we have first faced up to our doom, our dire predicament, the bad news of sin and judgment, God's verdict according to his law and his word, you're only ready for the remedy when you have accepted the divine diagnosis. Now watch as Micah turns from doom to hope, from judgment to the light of salvation dawning against the dark backdrop. Watch as the sun begins to rise. From a king being humiliated, now God will turn the tables. Another king in David's line would come, different and better than any king they'd ever known. We're going to look this morning very quickly, believe it or not, at eight characteristics. You didn't need to have Christmas lunch, did you? Eight characteristics of the incomparable babe of Bethlehem. We'll only look at the first few, and then I hope whet your appetite to explore the rest on your own. Eight characteristics of this incomparable babe of Bethlehem, the promised Christ child, so that we will receive him today in fulfillment of ancient prophecy, that you'll come to know him if you don't know him. God's greatest gift to humanity, worthy of all our praise and devotion. First characteristic is an ironic babe. Verse 2a, you could say. Look at the text. He's an ironic babe. Notice, but as for you, Bethlehem Ephrathah, too little to be among the clans of Judah. This is God, notice. He interrupts Micah's message with his own message of hope. From depressing images in verse 1, defeat and loss, he addresses now a little town whose very name conjures up hope. Anybody know what Bethlehem means? Beit, house, lehem, bread, house of bread. Ephrathah, Hebrew word for abundance, fruitfulness. Out of this one little town of Bethlehem, this single village, God would bring forth a babe who would feed our hungry souls, who would give life to a famished world. How impressive was little Bethlehem? Notice there it says in verse 2, too small, too little to be among, or it could be translated, for the clans of Judah. Go and read in Joshua. He wants to list in Judah, just one of the 12 tribes, the 100 cities that they conquered when they entered the promised land and possessed Canaan. Bethlehem doesn't even crack the knot, doesn't even feature on the list of top 100 towns in Judah. Oops. But now this town is on the map. What makes this little village so famous? It was a story that happened 300 years before Micah's time. If you know your Bible, it's the great story of Ruth and Naomi, right? The babe of Bethlehem has his roots in the romance of Bethlehem long before. Remember, tragedy and heartache had sent Naomi, this Jewish widow, back to her hometown of Bethlehem with a foreigner, daughter-in-law, a Moabite, Ruth, also widowed. The only one that could marry Ruth and redeem the family's name and their land and rescue her from her poverty and her misery and her plight would be next of kin, a Goel, a kinsman redeemer, related to her, but mightier and stronger than her, a husband that could rescue her. God provides Boaz to rescue, to redeem this outsider, Ruth. Boaz and Ruth end up having a great grandson who is no less than King David himself, Israel's greatest king. Centuries before Micah's prophecy, out of Bethlehem comes two great figures that are pointing to the coming Christ child. Boaz, a picture of Jesus who redeems us from our sin. And their great grandson, King David, from whose royal line Messiah must come. By the way, where also did Samuel go to anoint David as king, much to the disappointment of Saul? He was told to go and anoint David in the little place called Bethlehem, 1 Samuel 16. I love the way Francis Schaeffer once said, there are, in the Christian worldview, unlike the machinery of secularism with all of its dehumanizing, impersonal forces, Schaeffer loved to say, in the plan of God, there are no little people. And there are no little places. And if ever there is a town that teaches us that, it's Bethlehem. The plan of God taking on royal significance. And beloved, we know, if we are familiar with the scriptures, this messianic Christmas prophecy here is simply God narrowing down the exact portrait of the Savior of the world that he has been building all the way from the garden, right? So that we would recognize him when he comes and not miss it. The Bible's plot, the storyline so far has showed us in Genesis 3, it would be a crusher who would defeat Satan, reverse the curse on mankind. He wouldn't come from angels, wouldn't come from heavenly beings or some other supernatural creatures. He'd come through the seed of the woman, the human line of Eve's descendants. And then from Genesis 12, the picture narrows further, and we know that the nations would be blessed through Israel, through the descendants of Abraham, and through Isaac, not Ishmael, and through Jacob, not Esau. Narrowing, narrowing, narrowing. Genesis 49, Jacob prophesies Messiah would come through one of his 12 sons. Which of those? The line of Judah. The scepter wouldn't depart, we're told, till him to whom belongs the obedience of the nations. And then 2 Samuel 7, further focusing, tightening up and narrowing the picture, God declared out of all Judah's descendants, it wouldn't be any of David's mighty brothers, it'd be to David's line the Savior would come. I'll establish the throne of his kingdom forever. But now, Micah 5, it's narrowed down even further. This male offspring from Abraham's line through Isaac, Jacob, Judah, David would have to be born in one little village, 10 Ks outside of Jerusalem. This is pinpoint accuracy. This unlikely place, this ironic place of Bethlehem. And yet, come to think of it, where else would we expect him to arrive? The Savior, if not from the very place where King David was born and where the great redemption story of Ruth took place. Little Bethlehem, Nochol, as we say here, right? The Shire, as Tolkien would put it. Little places swept up into an epic drama in the plan of a sovereign God and his great salvation story. Little unimportant locations that breed a Boaz, a David, a Jesus that would change the course of history. Are we surprised if we know our New Testament? 1 Corinthians, consider your calling, brethren, he says to the Corinthians. You're not many mighty, you're not many wise, you're not many noble, you're not many strong. God has chosen the weak things of the world to shame the strong, the things that are not to shame the things that are, so that none would boast except in him. So he'll get the glory, not me and not you. When it comes to salvation, do you understand, friends? God doesn't want any of us acting like we are the next Olympic city, right? We're the next place that deserves to host the World Cup or whatever. Proud of what we've achieved, impressed with our religion, inflated with our own righteousness. No, God opposes the proud, but he gives grace to the humble. Scripture tells us those are the ones he saves. Nobodies, nothings, boasting only in Christ and his cross and his righteousness for our salvation. An ironic babe. Number two, and more briefly, not only ironic, but notice, a God-focused babe. A God-focused babe. Keep reading verse 2. He says, but as for you, Bethlehem Ephrathah, too little to be among the clans of Judah, from you one will go forth for me. Underline those two words, for me. Not for human benefit in the end, not for his own benefit, but supremely for God's glory, for God's benefit. I will provide for myself a king, he says in his word. He would be a man after God's own heart, more than David ever was. He'll do all that his father requires. Here we are entering into the 21st century. It's been said the 20th century, if the 18th century was the century of the Enlightenment, if the 19th century was a century of the Industrial Age and the great explorations, you know what historians are saying? The 20th century could be summed up as the century of self, the therapeutic age. Utterly narcissistically consumed with navel gazing. And here we have a Savior who lived not for himself, the most humble man who ever lived. He would go forth from God, for God, fulfilling God's purposes, bringing God's salvation. Number three, not only an ironic babe, a God-focused, or you could say a Godward babe. Number three, a royal babe, a royal babe. Keep reading in verse 2. From you will go forth for me to one will go forth for me to be ruler in Israel. We've seen already Judah's line, David's line, a king, a conqueror. He'd bring in an earthly kingdom, the peace and righteousness that Jews never had been able to achieve and all their other kings had failed to accomplish. Isaiah tells us this, one of the other great Christmas prophecies, Isaiah 9, for to us a child is born, to us a son is given, and the government will be on his shoulders, and he will be called Wonderful Counselor, Mighty God, Everlasting Father, Prince of Peace. And unlike any human king or any other kingdoms, Isaiah goes on to say in Isaiah 9, of the increase of his government and peace, there will be no end. He will reign on David's throne and over his kingdom, establishing and upholding with justice and righteousness from that time on and forever. And do we not exclaim with Handel's Messiah, and he will reign forever and ever. Hallelujah. Let me ask you, friend, who rules your life? Who is actually, honestly, those who know you best and in your own heart of hearts, who sits on that throne? Who is your king and governor? Who sets the rules? Who drives the show? Who determines the agenda? Who establishes your priorities? Is it the Lord Jesus? The only one qualified, worthy, able, rightly to rule and to govern us. The one who has died and now risen, who will rule over Israel and the universe one day. Why would we not yield to him now? Surrender full control to such a king and such a Lord, the royal babe of Bethlehem. But now we come to the fourth characteristic here. Best of all, the real shocker, the characteristic, if the others didn't do it for you, this puts the promised ruler utterly in a league of his own. Keep reading in verse 2. We've seen he's ironic, he's God-focused, he's royal, but most breathtaking of all, he is an eternal babe. Verse 2 says, his goings forth are from long ago, from the days of eternity. A child of prophecy, coming from no common stock, origins traced back long before King David, predating all the patriarchs. This Hebrew word here, his goings forth, his departures, his appearances, are from of old, from the days of eternity. In other words, his kingly activities, his royal visitations, his majestic appearances have been happening for a very long time. And at this point, we should be praying, go forth again to Lord today, Lord. Show yourself further in your splendor. Do your work now through your word in this very room while I'm preaching. I hope that's your prayer. But notice, he's been doing this from everlasting, before time began. It's a Hebrew phrase that can mean from ancient times. And of course, the Jewish skeptics who deny that Jesus is Messiah will quickly point that out. Oh, of course, from long ago. Except every time it's used with God, Elohim or Yahweh in the Old Testament, it always means from eternity, from everlasting. As Isaiah already tells about the coming Christ child, no less than Emmanuel, God with us, right? Isaiah 7, Isaiah 9, Mighty God, Everlasting Father. And this divine identity of the incomparable babe of Bethlehem is all the clearer when we open the pages of the New Testament, right? A certain Jesus of Nazareth is described in earth-shattering terms. Before Abraham was, I am, he says of himself, John 8, 58. That's pretty old. In fact, that's eternal. Apostle John, in his great Christmas prologue in John chapter 1, speaking of the babe of Bethlehem, in the beginning was, what? The Word. And the Word was with God, and the Word was God. He was with God in the beginning, and that eternal Word became flesh. Incarnation, enfleshment. I love the saying of the early church fathers, remaining what he was, he became what he was not. Deity took on a second nature, humanity. We've seen his glory, the glory of the one and only from the Father, full of grace and truth. Or as Hebrews chapter 1, God himself says about Jesus, his son, your throne, O God, will last forever and ever. I've just given you a few of the hundreds of references in the New Testament, proving this babe of Bethlehem was no less than God in the flesh, second person of the Trinity, God the Son, a babe with no beginning, an uncreated child. Look back at the text. His goings forth are from long ago, from the days of eternity. As we sing, Christ, by highest heaven adored, Christ, the everlasting Lord, late in time, behold him come, offspring of a virgin's womb. Veiled in flesh, the Godhead see. Hail the incarnate deity. Pleased as man with men to dwell, Jesus, our Emmanuel. Some of you are asking, well, hold on. How did the Jews interpret this prophecy? I mean, there's some really smart Jewish scholars, past and present. How do they get around this? And it's interesting. Some will say, well, this is Messiah's ancient Davidic descent. A Messiah, we're still waiting for it because he hasn't arrived yet. Problem is, that doesn't make sense because all Jewish origins are from ancient times, from Abraham. The Davidic line of Judah is no older than any other lineage in Israel or elsewhere for that matter. We all trace our roots back to Noah and Adam last time I checked. So that argument falls flat. Ah, but other Jewish scholars will say, ah, from long ago they named Messiah, or God had this idea of Messiah existing in his mind before the creation of the world. That's lovely, but that's not what the text says. It says God, this Messiah, this ruler, his goings forth, the Son of God, are from long ago. If I'm a secular, unreligious person, maybe this is you here today, first time you've been in church in a long time, and I come across an Old Testament, ancient Jewish prophecy like this, no matter how hard I try to explain it away, the stubborn truth still stares back at me, and I can't get around it, no matter how much I wiggle and duck and dive. In first century Bethlehem, when Mary bent over the manger and kissed the face of her newborn son, she kissed the face of God in the flesh. As we love to sing, don't we? God of God, light of light, lo, he abhors not the virgin's womb. Very God, begotten, not created. Oh, come, let us adore him. From verse 3, now Micah continues painting this glorious portrait of the babe of Bethlehem. We've already seen four traits of the Christ child. He gives four more characteristics. It's like an 8-point outburst. It's like this 8-part symphony of prophetic praise to the Christ of Christmas. I'll just give you the last four briefly in closing, leave you to study more on your own. We've seen that he is an ironic, a God-focused, a royal, and an eternal babe. Notice number 5, in verse 3, he is a restoring babe. A restoring babe. Keep reading. This great Christ-saturated prophecy is not over. Micah continues, therefore he, and rightly the NASB and some translations capitalize he, this is the Son of God, Messiah, he will give them up until the time when she who is in labor has borne a child. Then the remainder of his brethren will return to the sons of Israel. God gives up on Israel for a season because of her rebellion. But one day when Messiah is born in Bethlehem, this will signal a new work that God will do for his people. Only through Christ will these estranged Jews eventually be united and saved and brought under the scepter of King Jesus, restored to their God and their people. Romans 11 spells this out for us in the New Testament. You should be asking, am I restored? In your own life, have you allowed Christ to restore your broken relationships? Holidays have a way of highlighting the best and the worst of where our relationships are actually at. Do you know what it is to let the Prince of Peace actually heal hurt, overcome bitterness, and restore broken relationships that only the gospel and only the Bible can accomplish? Number 6, he's also a shepherding babe. Keep reading, verse 4. And he will arise and shepherd his flock in the strength of the Lord and the majesty of the name of the Lord his God. What kind of ruler will this incomparable babe be? Just another tyrant or despot, another fickle and unfaithful Jewish king like the many that they had already? Never, not so. The babe of Bethlehem will rise up and stand as God's anointed, uncontested ruler. Shepherd par excellence, the pasture everyone dreams of, the perfect provider and protector of his people. We live in an age again today of so many false shepherds, so many pretend spiritual leaders, the blind leading the blind so often. In such an age, there will be one who will be the ideal shepherd. He won't just be, notice, it's because he won't shepherd in his own strength. It'll be in divine empowering, the strength of God himself, it says there. Verse 4, he won't lead in his own name or authority, but in the majestic name of the Lord his God. This beautiful image, this rich biblical portrait of a David-like shepherd king becomes the palette from which the New Testament draws its rich colors to portray our Savior, the Lord Jesus. He is the great shepherd of the sheep, the New Testament tells us, the shepherd and guardian of our souls, the chief shepherd of the souls and the flock served by its leaders as under-shepherds. Jesus declares he's the good shepherd. He lays down his life for the sheep. He must fetch other sheep that are not of this Jewish fold. That's you and me, Gentiles, brought in through the gospel. Tell me where you'll find a better friend. Show me where you will find a better lover, a better Lord, a better leader. With a more perfect blend of majestic strength and tender love. Verse 4 is a beautiful description. Where else but in the Lord Jesus, friends, will you find the leader and the lover you long for? One that is clad in the royal robes of honor and watches over you with the eyes of love, holds on to you with strong arms and assures you, no one shall pluck you from my hands. I will never leave you or forsake you. Number 7, he's a world famous babe, a world famous babe. Keep reading verse 4. And they, God's people, will remain a picture of security, what every South African longs for, the ultimate armed response, the best health insurance, the perfect pension plan, real and lasting security. They will remain because at that time he will be great to the ends of the earth. When Christ returns, he sets up his kingdom. When the perfect president and the ultimate government arrives and is installed, then our shepherd king will have no rivals. He'll be the king of all kings, the Lord of all lords. No one will dare challenge him. What a day that will be. Only one celebrity left on the planet. Only one signature everybody wants. Only one superstar that deserves any attention at all. The Lord Jesus Christ, the incomparable babe of Bethlehem. And 8th and finally, we have seen he's not only ironic, a God-focused, a royal, an eternal babe, a restoring and a shepherding and a world-famous babe, but number 8, a peace-giving babe, a peace-giving babe. Look at how verse 5 really should be the same verse. It's kind of the end of the section there. This one will be our peace for Israel, for the world. True, lasting peace, the end of all bitter conflicts, permanent peace found only not in a place, but in a person, the Prince of Peace, as Isaiah prophesied. And this isn't just sweet harmony with one another and the nations. It begins with people having being reconciled to God, having their guilt removed and their sin forgiven. You can't have peace with others if you don't have peace with God, not in any deep and lasting permanent fashion, knowing that heaven's war against you is over, that Jesus took your punishment, that you can be forgiven by a holy God. Your judge can become your father through the blood of his son. We live in a peace-hungry world, don't we? More people than ever today on antidepressants, tranquilizers, happy pills, self-help programs, because often they can find no peace anywhere else. The Bible warns there is no rest for the wicked. There is no peace for those who do not know God. And they're looking for it in all the wrong places, and they will not find it until they bow before the Prince of Peace. And you can know this peace with God. You can have a living, vital, permanent love relationship. What all these weddings our church has been celebrating this month, including tomorrow, portray this covenant, joyful, glad, happy union with the Lord Jesus Christ, us as his bride, his church. I close with this. My dear wife had the intelligence I didn't have in university. We both studied at master's. You had the option of a semester, our son has done this as well, studying in Israel. I was too distracted with whatever else to sign up for that, busy with basketball and less spiritual things. She studied there for a whole semester. They went in 1995, I'm not trying to give away her age, to the Church of the Nativity. And Michelle had a unique experience. Limousines were arriving. Huge groups, bodyguards, officials, followers. There was a whole entourage, and everyone else that was there for tourism was told to stay back because a royal dignitary was in the house. And at the center was President Daniel Arap Moi of Kenya, holding his royal scepter. You're coming to the Church of Nativity to worship Jesus, and you couldn't leave your scepter behind. Another of the many dictators that are ravaging this continent and destroying our peace because they are self-worshiping fools. Just like across the world without Jesus. What a contrast to the humble way that Jesus came to Bethlehem. What a contrast. Worldly rulers are in comparison to God's true ruler, King Jesus. Out of Bethlehem, we're told God's own son would arise, the perfect shepherd, the only ruler ever to have eternal origins, the only ruler who would one day achieve world peace. But God's ruler arrives in Bethlehem, not with an entourage and limousines and bodyguards, but on a donkey in a cold, dark manger. He comes not with a scepter, but in swaddling clothes. Have you joined King Jesus in his entourage? Are you his real follower? If not, I plead with you, I urge you today, give your life to follow him. Acknowledge him today as the true fulfillment of all that Micah prophesied, God's eternal ruler, shepherd, and Lord who demands your entire devotion and your full allegiance. Let's bow as we pray. O little town of Bethlehem, how still we see thee lie. Above thy deep and dreamless sleep, the silent stars go by. Yet in thy dark streets shineth the everlasting light. The hopes and fears of all the years are met in thee tonight. O holy child of Bethlehem, descend to us, we pray. Cast out our sin and enter in. Be born in us today. We hear the Christmas angels, the great glad tidings tell. Oh, come to us, abide with us, our Lord, Emmanuel. Oh, Lord, this is our prayer that the Christ child, the incomparable babe of Bethlehem, the Lord of heaven and earth, the risen King, the crucified and exalted and coming Savior, that any who do not know him today would turn and fall on their face and stop seeking peace and hope and comfort in anyone or any place else, but in the Lord Jesus Christ, the only one worthy of all our trust, the only one who has proven by his perfect life and his atoning death and his empty tomb and his power to save so many of us who are here today as trophies of your grace. We are no better, we are no smarter, we are no more moral or religious, but by your grace alone, you have humbled us to see our sin, to see that we are little Bethlehems, and you have shown us our need for a Savior. We rejoice, O God, that you demonstrate your own love toward us, and that while we were yet sinners, Christ died for us. We pray that that gospel would ring out in our hearts and minds as we go from this place. We who know you would be all the more devoted to follow you. In our Savior's great name we pray. Amen.